And now, already running like a tiger on my right side, it's a great pleasure introducing one of the biggest physicians in our field, Professor Cesare Hassan from Rome. And Professor Hassan is really someone who is doing research not only now since a couple of years, but really since more than far by a decade, responsible for all our guidelines, important guidelines, specifically in this field, from the European Society of Gastrointestinal Endoscopy. And Cesare, of course, it's your biggest challenge now to answer how we can optimize and maximize specifically our adenoma detection rate, because I think this is not always that easy, but we are very keen to learn from you about the future. Thank
Helmut,
you.
But do you read our guidelines? So, ladies and gentlemen, thanks for the deepest part of my heart for being so many in this late afternoon. Really, thanks for being with us. But, of course, Foodly always innovative, always good to learn the last from this company. Sylvia was perfect. Didactic, logical, numbers, data. She's always very beautiful, very sweet. I promise I will be the opposite. So, I'm not an advanced endoscopist as Helmut or Pradeep. So what I do in my life is a very dirty job. I do mostly screening colonoscopy from morning to the afternoon. How many of you do screening colonoscopy in this room? Raise your hand. Okay. You do screening colonoscopy, Helmut?
Yeah.
I want to see you do an ESD or something like that. Okay. So, it's quite hard to do screening colonoscopy all the day. You may also say that it is quite boring or it is quite stupid. I accept everything. But what is more frustrating is that after putting so much in a screening colonoscopy, we still miss one every three. Adenoma. So, when I read the last meta-analysis by Chinese, I said, okay, but this is just a meta-analysis, I'm much better, I am dedicated, I put passion and blah, blah, blah. But then I also do study like Sylvia, and we did a tandem study 2 or 3 years ago with the Enduring. You know, Helmut, what happened? No. Helmut?
What happened?
Yeah. Don't look at the phone, you're worse than my kid. Okay, so I realized that I miss one every three adenoma. So it's quite frustrating that despite our passion and our dedication, we still miss so many adenoma. And of course, Sylvia anticipated me that probably there is an insufficient contrast between the neoplasia and the mucosa, because it is pink on pink, red on pink, whitish red on pink. It's always pink. It's quite difficult to detect this polyp. And in addition, it's quite difficult to expose all the mucosa. So with Fuji, in the last years, we are trying to address each of them with a particular strategy. And of course, you already heard about what Helmut defined as the bright chromoendoscopy to differentiate from the dark or blue light, to scope with LCI, something that we can do, to scope in detection with BLI, something that after 1 hour kill you dead, so to be too tiring, okay? But what lazy people like me like is something that is easier. And this is quite similar to have a PlayStation where you have this box that indicates you where to go. And so this is the project on artificial intelligence that Helmut and myself had the privilege to share. And basically what we did was to collect nearly 1,000 polyps, and then additional polyps came from Japan to create a large data set. I want very briefly to comment with you Helmut this data set. This data set was of a consecutive polyps. And it was extremely time-consuming that we took this polyp in all the possible modality with the four LED light generator that you have on your Fuji. And all of these images were annotated manually by Japanese heroes who really work night and day to do all of this annotation. And then the mathematical algorithm to create this to create the matrix, the mathematical matrix that recognizes the polyp have been created. And all of this has been incorporated in CAD-i, that is the device that is already built, that is already alive, that's been produced by Fuji. And here you may see also from aesthetical point of view, it's very, very attractive. So let me show you now the first ever image list on the detection mode of this system. So, do you agree, Helmut, if I show first the video without CAD, okay? This must be you, because I don't do retroflexion. So you are paranoid, you are always retroflexing, okay. Okay, so this is the first video, okay? So have a look at this video. This is retroflexion, and of course you expose a lot of mucosa when you are in retroflexion, and then before the new, the system detect the lesion. And once the lesion is detected, it continues to be pinpoint frame after frame. So even if you don't detect the box at the first frame, you will detect at the subsequent frame. Helmut, did you recognize the polyp before or after the CAD?
No, I have not seen it before.
I mean, you are honest. I've never seen any endoscopy telling me, oh, no, I was a bit in delay. No. Okay, no, this system is definitely faster than most of us. But, of course, we need to do a validation study, and this study was based this time not in Como, but quite close in Milan. And what we did was to randomize in between an expert group that was done by two expert endoscopists who were looking at the images, and then a group of non-expert plus CAD, in the background idea that if you have a non-expert, you add CAD-i, the performance in detection can improve. And this time I give data as a CV, okay? So the sensitivity of the expert with the white light and LCI was extremely promising, but also the non-expert plus CAD-i performed equally good. And CAD-i by itself was nearly as the expert. And these values of sensitivity, I mean, sensitivity close to 100% is something you must believe. It's something that with this algorithm is possible. So this system are definitely consistent and robust. And Helmut, I feel that this is what we were looking for, because too many times in colonoscopy we had something that was unpredictable, not working on the cases, and blah, 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 blah. I feel that now finally we have something that is solid. We have a solid basis to create a new colonoscopy. Of course, you must have some information when you use a software, and this is something that all of us must learn. At the beginning, I was a bit allergic, but after some examination, you get used. An endoscopist must know if the CAD is active or non-active. A CAD may be non-active for several reasons, but mostly because you deactivate it with no purpose. So the CAD must be active. And then you have this detection box, but especially you have a sound detection. The sound detection is like this. It's very nice music, but it really wakes you up. I don't know why, but without the sound detection, just the box is not enough. It doesn't wake you up so suddenly. I really like the sound. The sound for me is 90% of the increase in attention. And then, of course, there is in what part of the screen the polyp is detected, and this also drives you in the right direction. So this is all the information that you have here. You see that the CAD can be on or can be off. And then when the lesion comes, now you see this part, this is the box. I mean, we have not seen this part, we must be honest. I mean, just the, I've seen maybe the box. So it's already difficult for me to detect the box. Just imagine the polyp that was behind the box. Maybe in the future we will be high detector for boxes rather than for polyp. Okay, but you never know, okay. So the next task, and we must pay tribute to Fujifilm here to take the lead. Of course, you know about AIDLI in the United States, but here in Europe, definitely Fujifilm took the lead. And this is to characterize the lesion. And of course, Silvia told you that we can probably leave out the idea to use a blue light endoscopy for detection. It's too much cumbersome. But for characterization, any of us believe in a blue light characterization. But maybe once you have the lesion, you don't need to ask yourself if the pits are round, not round, the vessel, blah, 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 blah. Because this takes time, and in a lot of small polyp may be a bit confounding. So you can have a CAD that tell you if the polyp is hyperplastic or adenomatous. And of course, we applied the same randomized approach to characterization, and you may see that the CAD actually overperform against humans, and also I'm against expert. I mean, I want to be good with the expert. These were video not necessarily collected for characterization. So sometimes the polyp was not 6 o'clock, very far, okay, and you were asked to characterize, and we couldn't give information about the confidence level that we had. But the computer did better than us. Of course, maybe I'm expecting here a bit more from the computer, but we still have time before it is released in the market. Again, the graphic is very important. It's like the flag of the Brazil. So if it is a neoplastic lesion, you see a yellow part where the presumed polyp is located. So, and if it is hyperplastic, it is green. So here, from this map, you have two information. One is if the polyp that you are expected to characterize is the one that you are really characterizing. And the second, immediately from the colon, if it is an adenoma or an hyperplastic. And then if you don't remember the color, you can anywhere read here neoplastic or hyperplastic. In the case of multiple polys, in the case of confusion, you will have an indicator that give you the confidence of the system in its diagnosis. Look at this, Helmut, okay? So you can follow here the polyp. You see that it's yellow, and this indicate adenoma. Do we need histology, Helmut, after we remove this polyp for you? Would you send to histology, or would you trust the computer?
So honestly, I think we are not that far at the moment, totally to trust, but we are very pretty close.
Okay, so we are getting close. I mean, according to Helmut, probably next year. No, because we are pretty close, so probably 1 year. November. Now technology is very fast.
November 30 is a deadline for
it's
us.
November 30. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, and then you have here when it is upper plastic, so it is a big double, completely green on the right side, and this is hyperplastic. And my dear Helmut, when I see a small hyperplastic polyp, I do not remove, because my life is precious, my time is precious. I don't waste time in removing hyperplastic lesion. SSP, yes, but hyperplastic, please. Okay, so what we have, as you may guess, is the immediate integration of CAD-i in your Fuji tower. It is extremely easy. Nurses are very happy. There is no more room and blah, blah, blah. You can record your movie. And I like this step ahead. I mean, in 2020, finally, even the scope can record video. And then it is a push button technology. So you have here one button, and you activate or deactivate the CAD. And this is my very ugly hand, but I want to show you that you can pass from a BLI to LCI, and the same time the CAD pass from detection to characterization and then detection again. Of course, when you have this system, you do all colonoscopy with the CAD activated. So in summary, this is what in just very short time this Japanese engineer did, and I feel that we should pay tribute to them, Helmut, because there is a lot of job behind this technology. We consider it so easy to use. Really took a hard job for them to do, to test, to validate, to redo, etc. But then when you see the sound, is very nice. I really like this sound. So it detects the polyp and anoma, and you turn, and in real time it characterizes. This is not the future. This is the present. CAD-i will be very shortly, very, very shortly, on your tower. Of course, the detection mode has been trained with both white light and LCI. So when I was with Helmut very short time ago, we had this discussion. We feel that at the end, the choice of the light between LCI and white light will also depend on how much the system is reactive, okay? Because Helmut, if the system works both in white light and LCI, we can do the examination irrespectively in what you prefer the most. On the other hand, if LCI add not to us, but to the computer, at that point, LCI would be a way to facilitate the computer and not the endoscopy. So I'm a bit sorry, but I feel that Sylvia needs to redo all the study based on what the computer feels. Of course, there's no exception. Characterization will be done in BLI. I know that a lot of you feel that characterization with computer could be done in white light. No. We tried. No. BLI not only give more to the endoscopies like Helmut, Pradeep, etc., give also more to the computer. Of course, you have a very few false positives. When I say very few, means something that doesn't disturb you. And the reason for a false positive are very easy to be identified. In cases, by sucking, we created a pseudo fold, pseudo polyp that was actually a fold. But when you are used to use a CAD, as soon as you recognize Helmut, that is speed pattern one, that is so normal, you don't pay attention, you don't waste time. So there's no reason to be worried. And as also we can argue, and this comes from Pradeep, false positive not only affect computer, false positive affect only also us. when we see this Helmut, anyway we would stop, we would watch, we would see behind. So it's a bit unbalanced to say, oh, but the system has false positive. No, also the human eye has false positive. So you want to recheck the fault, you want to recheck the bubble and blah, blah, blah. So don't be too nasty with the system, Helmut. Okay, so the second point, and then I close, is that we want to see better behind the default, because this is a concept that Helmut should be clarified. If we don't expose the mucosa, CAD eye cannot detect the polyp. If the polyp is not in the screen, CAD help zero. So you need to expose this mucosa that is behind the fold. And in the proximal colon, as you may see, there are a lot of nick where the polyp can hide. And so I feel that most of you already know the balloon of the eye that you can inflate once you are in the cecum to put down the fold of the proximal colon, but also of the left colon. In the left colon, usually you have a straightening effect. And this is very similar, as a mechanism of action to endocath. I mean, at the end, the two systems have the same purpose. This is the same patient. I'm very proud, Elmo, because I did this video, okay? A lot of people say, oh, no, but Cesar doesn't do endoscopy. No, I do endoscopy. This is a video I did. And you may see that on the left, the folds are completely hiding the interostral space. But when you withdraw with the... bastard. Okay. But when you withdraw with the balloon, you are actually able to strengthen the mucosa, and it appears like... so much with atrophic gastritis, where you can really spot any polypoid lesion. And of course, most of you are already aware that there is evidence supporting this. Probably this also can be extended to endocarp, and I know that Pradeep has a controversial truth about endocarp, but I feel that to flatten the fold is something that can help at least some endoscopies. And then if you think the double balloon enteroscopy, of course the balloon can stabilize you when you do a complex EMR and etc. I feel that this was the last slide. Thanks for the attention.
Wow, I think this was very impressive, Cesare. Thank you so much, because I think the room is totally full. Congratulations to Fujifilm, because I think despite the late time, we are all very interested and we never stop. But we have learned that this seems to be a really historical moment, is it? Because you have shown us in your slides that for the first time ever, Fujifilm is now introducing not only a detection system, but also a characterization system, and we are all very much involved in multiple classifications over the past years, but now it seems that we do not need any classifications anymore in the future. And initially I have explained that we are learning from Japan, of course, a lot, and also languages, and Riley is being smart, being intelligent. Should we all now be Riley? Should we all now use artificial intelligence?
I mean, the first point is completely right, but we cannot say before Pratik Sharma talk. But of course, the use of classification, no, will become less and delay. Is it a bit when laparoscopic surgery came? Do surgeons need to do open surgery when you can do laparoscopy? So what is the training? So I feel that probably in the curriculum, Helmut, we can still consider a place for the classification. But I agree with you that in clinical practice, this will be mostly deviated by artificial intelligence. And I want to expand a bit the scenario, because artificial intelligence has been now applied to endoscopy. but it's been applied to dermatology since some time. For instance, I had a mole and I was a bit worried, and my wife always tell me, oh, you're going to die by melanoma. Okay. So I took this app, I did the control of myself, it was very easy. So also dermatology send every lesion to histology. So I feel that there may be some favorable contamination between dermatology and endoscopy, according to which we don't send hyperplastic polyp to histology and possibly adenoma, and they will not send a mole that are very far from being a melanoma to histology. So I hope that there is some contamination, some multidisciplinary contamination, because if not, everyone will continue to send to histology. And this is something that from some point, someone need to stop. Pradeep.
Excellent talk, Cesare, as always. I think one of the things crossing my mind is I feel really sad for you doing a dirty job every day from morning to afternoon. Yeah. Some of us do a boring job of training our trainees every day. With this technology now, we don't need to do that. Why do we need to train them to detect polyp? Why do we need to train them to characterize polyp? Just train them to get to cecum. Mm-hmm. And then have adequate inflation. Why do you need a balloon? I just inflate the colon, the folds will flatten. AI should find the polyp, characterize the polyp, job done.
Mm-hmm. I mean, this is a very good point, because first of all, it reminds us how much important, but also how much hard is to train a fellow to learn a new technique. Can this system help? Yes, not only us, but also the patient. First, it helped us, because I was with you in the room while you were training the fellow, and sometimes you were just chatting on your email while the fellow was doing the examination. So while you are chatting, the system is still looking at the screen. So it's impossible for a human mind to look at fellow 100% of the time from 8 o'clock to 5 p.m. So anyway, I feel that there is some stabilization in the training. So the impact of CAD in training will be huge, huge. And I guess, but you are much more expert than me, I guess that the problem of recognition covers most of the problem of upper GI. Because in upper GI, it's quite simple to expose all the mucosa. What triggers the difficulty of upper GI endoscopy is the detection of a very flat and very advanced neoplasia, okay? Colonoscopy, unfortunately, has two troubles. One is to recognize the lesion, and I fully agree with you that this will help in training. But the second is to expose the mucosa. First of all, I don't know what part is more difficult, okay? And secondly, I feel that the contribution of artificial intelligence to our science, forget if I leave out the clinical practice, is that we will learn finally how much of the miss rate is due to problem of polyp recognition and how much of incomplete exposure of the mucosa. When Pradeep will use artificial intelligence to address the issue, I would tell you, and of course you would tell me, how much of the training system can be just left out to the computer. But if we could have a software that tells us how much of the mucosa is covered, I would be more confident to leave my trainee out and continue chatting.